Hi, and welcome to Enchantment of Eternity's review of Who Watches the Watchers, which is the fourth episode of the third season of Star Trek The Next Generation. This video is part of a series of videos I'm doing where I review episodes of Star Trek as requested by you, the viewer.
This episode was requested by Dwiking62.
If there is an episode you'd like to request, you just have to leave a comment below. It can be any episode from any of the Star Trek, five Star Trek series, but please one episode per person. So, Who Watches the Watchers starts out when a horrible accident occurs to a group of anthropologists who are studying a primitive Vulcan-like alien species behind a holographic shield that camouflages them from the native people. When the Enterprise goes to rescue them, one of the natives discovers them and suffers a life-threatening injuries due to the accident, so Dr. Crusher beams him aboard to save his life. While on board, he wakes up and sees Picard acting all godlike, so when he returns to the planet and Dr. Crusher's attempts to erase his memory fails, that's exactly what he becomes convinced of, that Captain Picard is a god, which ends up causing all sorts of trouble as they kidnapped an injured scientist, and after Riker and Troy go undercover to rescue him, they end up capturing Troy instead, and they want to sacrifice her to the god they are calling the Picard. So Captain Picard tries desperately to convince them he is no god. So this is really an interesting episode. However, on the surface, it has a lot of problems, and it isn't all that appealing. The native people, the Mentakans, come off as a bit bland and stereotypical. When Riker and Troy are prepping for the mission, Troy talks about their different social structures. However, when we actually see them, they just come off as normal people. And I know they're supposed to be primitive and Vulcan-like, but on screen, it just looks like bad acting, as they seem really stiff and cardboard-like. And although I know Star Trek does this a lot, but with this episode is one of the worst examples of them showing about 10 people and calling it a society. You know, I know they're limited by budget constraints and can't actually have like hundreds of extras, and this was the days before CGI was commonplace, so they couldn't fake an entire society, such as Enterprise did a fairly good job at doing this, you know, but still, they showed 10 to 15 people at a time, and Picard was acting like this religion would spread to the entire planet. I understand a religion might spread through word of mouth, but again, it's just 15 people, and most of these people wouldn't believe Liko until they saw a human for themselves, so maybe it's plausible these 15 people can start a religion that will spread to the whole planet, but I wouldn't even call it likely, and yet Picard and the anthropologists were acting like it was a foregone conclusion. Another thing worth noting is when this episode was made, and that was the beginning of season 3, so at this point in the series, it had just finished the first two seasons, which were, to put it kindly, subpar. Season 3 was a huge turnaround for the show, as it was a massive change in tone, and where the very first episode of season 3 looked and felt completely different from any previous episodes. Season 3 resembles more of what we now think of The Next Generation, as this tone would carry out for the rest of the series run. But at this time, this was a fresh and a whole new different direction for the show. However, the very beginning of season 3 still carried some elements of the cheesiness of the first two seasons, which is kind of noticeable in this episode in the stiff and cliched way the Mentakans behaved, and how the Enterprise crew relates to them. All that aside, the story is what I would call mildly interesting, where at first they have to save some scientists, but after messing that up, they have to save Troy. However, what makes this episode so interesting and noteworthy is its commentary on the Federation's fictional society and by implication on our modern day society. First of all, I want to talk about what this episode is really about, and that is the Prime Directive. I've heard a lot of criticism of the way Picard behaves in this episode, as he kind of comes off as an asshole, as he says things like this.
It was either bring him aboard or let him die.
Then why didn't you let him die?
Because we were responsible for his injuries.
I'm not sure that I concur with that reasoning, Doctor.
And like this.
Picard, I must protest. You're endangering Palmer with this delay.
I am aware of that. But each of us, including Dr. Palmer, took an oath that we would uphold the Prime Directive. If necessary, with our lives.
But I think some of these people don't fully grasp the importance of the Prime Directive, mainly because we never really had anything like this on Earth on a large scale. So more modernized societies interfere with primitive societies right and left. And it's fair to say that in many cases, they decimated those societies by doing so. But the Prime Directive is one of the key components of Gene Roddenberry's vision of the future. It should be noted that Roddenberry hadn't fully developed his vision of the future during the original series run. And in addition, there was a lot of studio interference to make it more Western-like and more acceptable to mainstream audiences. And Roddenberry was basically kicked off of the Star Trek films after the disaster that was the first film. So The Next Generation was really his playing ground to fully develop and to preach his utopian vision of the future. And this is the most apparent in the first four seasons of The Next Generation, and I would hold this episode as a prime example of him attempting to do so, particularly concerning the Prime Directive. The concept of the Prime Directive is based on several things. As I mentioned before, the devastation that comes when more advanced societies interfere with less advanced, which results in disease, alcoholism, erosion of their traditional culture, and also a theoretical situation in which aliens are visiting Earth, and the reason they don't announce their presence or make themselves known is because they know that humans aren't ready for such revelations. That aspect of it is explored a bit more in the fourth season episode, First Contact. The episode, not the movie. This episode is more about what is best described in a quote from noted science fiction author Arthur C. Clarke, who is noted as stating that any significant technology would be indistinguishable from magic, which seems to be a logical conclusion that a race as advanced as the Federation would appear as magical beings to a group of pre-industrial tribe-like aliens. So Picard in this episode is being like the voice of Roddenberry, saying that any direct interference would be more devastating than actively trying to help them. As Star Trek is meant to be an advanced vision of a society of humans who are more advanced and wise than our present-day society is, who thinks everything can be fixed through interference. The Prime Directive is Roddenberry's vision of if a group of people travel throughout space, interfering with less advanced cultures willy-nilly, they would leave a wake of disaster behind. So this is the preachy episode meant to illustrate how the importance of the Prime Directive is paramount. This was touched upon slightly in the first season episode, Justice, and the second season episode, Pen Pals. But I would say this episode is where we get more into depth about its importance. As despite pressures such as the anthropologist's suggestion that Picard go down and pose as a god to tell them in Tokens what to do, Picard sticks to his laurels and manages to resolve the situation by mostly honoring the Prime Directive. In fact, he is willing to sacrifice his own life rather than violate the Prime Directive, which shows you how important it is to him. Now, this episode presents a rather simplistic view of the Prime Directive compared to later episodes that really test and challenge its concepts, such as the seventh season episode, Homebound. and indeed later spin-offs that occur after Roddenberry's death, such as Deep Space Nine, and in particular Voyager, will often ignore the Prime Directive in favor of more interesting and exciting plots. This part of The Next Generation is where it was firmly in Roddenberry's grasp, and it shows. The other more controversial aspects of the commentary of this episode makes is that it is seen by many as an attack against religion. And I'm not entirely sure I agree. Although I must admit, when I was in my late teens and I was a hardcore atheist who was on an anti-religion kick, I considered this one of my favorite episodes. However, now that I'm a bit older and wiser, I still consider myself an atheist, but I am a bit more tempered and actually see the view that this episode presents of religion as a tad bit simplistic. However, when I say it's controversial, I mean among Star Trek fans and people who pay attention. One of the great things about Star Trek is because it hides its social commentary in science fiction, it's able to go over the heads of many of the general public that is making, you know, social commentary, which is how the original series got away with making many of its commentary in the 60s that would have typically not been allowed to air on mainstream television for the fear of alienating audiences. So in this case, there were no large-scale Christian protests against it like there was for movies like Dogma or Harry Potter. And of course, one of the main reasons of this is because it wasn't nearly as popular. And in the case of Harry Potter, that's a huge understatement. But I would say other reasons would be because its anti-religion message was not as conspicuous to the average viewer. However, I have noted many complaints amongst the more religious Star Trek fans about this episode. I remember as a teenager reading this book called The Nitpicker's Guide to Star Trek, and for this episode it claimed that they were being very blunt in their anti-religious stance, and he challenged them by saying, 95% of the world believe in some form of supreme being or another. Are you saying that they're all wrong? And I remember when I first read this, I was screaming, yes, yes, that's exactly what they're saying. Something I always quoted was, just because a belief is popular doesn't make it true. I particularly like the scene from The Bucket List where Morgan Freeman's character challenges Jack Nicholson's character with the same point about 95% of the world believing God. You know, you're saying they're all wrong, and Nicholson replies, if there's anything I learned in life, it's that 95% of the world are always wrong. I love that quote. Anyway, I'm not so sure this episode is as anti-religion as I and many people thought it was, but let's watch the scene that has that's seen as the most controversial in this regard.
Millennia ago, they abandoned their belief in the supernatural. Now you are asking me to sabotage that achievement, to send them back into the dark ages of superstition and ignorance and fear? No!
Okay, that scene was loaded with many things that may seem to be anti-religious. First off, it's the anthropologist's submission that this particular religion, and by implication all religions, could lead to holy wars, inquisitions, and chaos. Next we have Picard basically saying that if these people believed in a supreme being again, it would bring about a dark age of superstition, ignorance, and fear. So first off, let me address the anthropologist's statements and why they may not be as anti-religion as they appear. Because his whole argument is that this religion could lead to these horrible things only if left unchecked. His main suggestion is that Picard go to the planet and pretend to be God in order to give the Mentalkins guidance. So on the face of it, what he's saying is that religion isn't inherently bad and won't necessarily lead to holy wars and inquisitions, only religions that are misguided, which is why he wants Picard to simply nudge them in the right direction. And this is a notion I'd actually agree with, that religions aren't inherently bad, is when they are misguided and used by the corrupt to gain more power that they can turn a bit disastrous, which is why I disagree with the most common interpretation of what he said, which is what I had initially thought as well, that he was saying that religion is directly responsible for horrors such as the Holy Wars and Inquisitions, which I now see as a bit of an overly simplistic view, that these atrocities were more the result of people's lust for power who simply used religion as a tool in order to gain more power at the expense of many other people's lives. Meaning religion wasn't directly responsible, it was simply a tool a few very corrupt and powerful people used to control the masses. Had it not been religion, they would have simply used another tool. So even in my modern interpretation of the anthropologist's words, I still kind of disagree with him, as he's saying religion could lead to these things. Well, I would argue it would have more to do with how society and civilization was structured on this world. Now, let's get to Picard's statement that seem unfavorable to religion, any which way you slice it, as he's basically equating the belief of a supreme being with ignorance and superstition. But in his defense, he is referring to a very specific belief based off of information he knows is false, because they are starting to believe in a very specific god, him, and he knows he isn't a god. So he knows for a fact that their religion would be based off of lies. If, for example, the Mantakans have mistaken something else that had nothing to do with them for a god, Picard would be A-okay with that. In fact, the Prime Directive would dictate that he not interfere and let them create a religion regardless of the outcome. Picard's main concern here is stifling their progress by creating a religion which he knows to be based off of misconception. So you can interpret his words as he thinks any belief in a supreme being as a creator would lead to a disaster, or you can interpret simply that he doesn't want to be responsible for creating a belief in a supreme being that could severely alter the natural progression of this planet's development, and thus be one of the most gross violations of the Prime Directive you could think of. Ultimately, however, I view this scene and overall this episode as being more anti-organized religion than it is anti-belief in the supreme being. I think the most obvious message here isn't anti-religion, but pro-science. And these two concepts aren't always mutually exclusive. Many scientists are religious. The message here is never to dismiss logic or reason in favor of unsubstantiated supernatural beliefs. And I think this interpretation is supported by many philosophical scenes with Picard and other episodes that make it clear that he is open-minded to many beliefs and, you know, open to explanations that try to explain big questions such as where did the universe come from and what happens to us when we die. So I don't think Picard was saying that to believe that a supreme being or greater force is at work is ignorance. He is saying that religious belief should never trump or interfere with solid logical reasoning. And in that, I totally agree, which is why I really like this episode. So overall, the plot is a bit ordinary, the dialogue and acting is a bit subpar, but I commend this episode for its philosophical examinations of more advanced cultures and the effects they can have on less advanced cultures, and how religious beliefs shouldn't interfere with rational thinking. So my rating for this episode out of 10 is a 7. Very good. So that's it for my review of Who Watches the Watchers. If there's an episode from any of the 5 Star Trek series you would like me to review next, just comment below and let me know which episode. And be sure you subscribe to keep up with all that. And thanks a lot for watching.